In great deeds, something abides. On great fields, something stays. Bodies disappear, but spirits linger. And reverent men and women from afar, generations that know us not and that we know not of, shall come to this deathless field to ponder and dream. And the power of the vision pass into their souls. This is the great reward of service. This is the mystery of Christ. To give life's best for such high sake that it shall be found again unto life eternal. Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain.
The Battle of Gettysburg is familiar to most of us, but we wanted something more. Beyond the clash of two great armies are the stories of individual soldiers who found Christ amidst the chaos. We're in search of the God story of Gettysburg. Our adventure starts here at Cornerstone Network on top of our mountain outside of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania. Early on the morning of June 1st, we prepared to head out on a very special journey. The morning was cold and gray, but it didn't dampen the enthusiasm of our guests. Bags had to be loaded, and nearly 50 people had to get on board. We're heading to Gettysburg, Pennsylvania, to meet our good friend Dennis Kuchner, a pastor who gives tours that show the Christian perspective of the battlefield. The bus was filled, and we're ready to take off.
Well, Terry, the time has finally come. I'm excited that today is the day we're going to go. We're taking a bus full of friends and partners to the ministry, and we're going to go watch and look at the God story of Gettysburg. Because everybody knows the battle was fought, but what about behind the scenes? What about hearing what God did?
That's right.
Because
really
God's
awesome.
In everything. So let's go. Let's go to Gettysburg.
Once settled in, our 3.5-hour road trip gave us time to watch the film Gettysburg. This epic war movie tells the story of the battle from both sides, helping set the stage for the adventure that lay ahead of us. We were all very excited.
The part that interests me a whole lot is getting the Christian view of the battlefield. This will be my 8th time there, and this I consider to be one of the best, if not the best, trip that I've taken to Gettysburg.
It'll be great. It'll be really great. My husband is a Civil War buff. I'm just the tag along, but I can enjoy it.
Gettysburg was one of the largest battles of the Civil War and a turning point. So being able to see this, to go over and reflect, and to see the faith of many men on both sides, they were all fighting for God. But God put one country together at the end of this thing. So how it turned out was the way he wanted it to.
We made our way across the state through some pretty nasty weather. But by the time we arrived, the sun was shining and most of the rain had dried up. For lunch, we stopped at General Pickett's Buffet, a special restaurant named for the famous Confederate general, filled with historic memorabilia. We enjoyed some good old-fashioned country cooking before heading out to the hotel to unpack. But we didn't have much time to rest as our tour was just about to begin. In 1863, Gettysburg was a small town of only 3,000 people, mostly known for its Lutheran seminary and Gettysburg College. Students studied the scriptures while farmers tended to their fields and orchards in the rocky Pennsylvania soil. By the middle of the 19th century, a divide was widening between the northern and the southern people. No place was this more evident than Washington, D.C. Politicians strongly disagreed on many points, including states' rights, the role of the federal government, and most of all, slavery. The argument tore our nation apart. Churches divided, splintering into new denominations. Christian abolitionists prayed for forgiveness of what they called the country's original sin. For years, the states had been held together by negotiations and compromise, but time and patience had run out. With the election of anti-slavery President Abraham Lincoln in 1861, 11 southern states officially seceded from the Union to form the Confederate States of America. Soon the nation plunged into civil war. During the first 2 years of fighting, despite a smaller population and less industrial power, the Confederates won the majority of the battles, prolonging what the Union had hoped to be a short and easy conflict. In the summer of 1863, Confederate General Robert E. Lee knew that the war-wearied North was tired of fighting. He hoped that a decisive victory on Union soil would force the Northern politicians to abandon the unpopular war and allow the Confederacy to freely exist without conflict. Confederate troops began to take control of southern Pennsylvania. In need of supplies, the Army of Northern Virginia foraged their way across farms, taking whatever they could find. One southern division made its way to Gettysburg, looking for food, clothing, and shoes. In a move to protect Washington, Union troops began coming in from the south, and on July 1st, 1863, the battle began. The Battle of Gettysburg would prove to be the bloodiest in American history. In 3 days, nearly 50,000 men were killed or injured. It would become the turning point in both the war and our nation's history. Never since has America witnessed such a violent loss of so many lives on our own soil. Yet, in the middle of the horror, there are stories of courage, of honor, and of patriotism. Our group came to Gettysburg to reflect on the sacrifices made by these men and boys who fought this battle so long ago. We traveled to discover the stories of hope, of healing, of restoration, as only God could provide. Our first stop was at the historic Christ Church in downtown Gettysburg. In the early 1800s, the town's population consisted mainly of German immigrants, most of which were Lutheran Christians. In 1826, the Lutherans established a seminary in Gettysburg. Gettysburg already had one Lutheran church, but the sermons were conducted only in German. Wanting to spread their faith to others, the Lutherans established Christ Church as an English-speaking congregation. Students attended services here, the college held graduation ceremonies in the sanctuary, and locals even used the building for town meetings. But during the summer of 1863, soldiers used the church for something entirely different, as historian Ron Rock explains.
This area was Union territory, and Union officers coming up and down Chambersburg Street in front of the church here saw this building and decided to use it as a hospital. So starting on the morning of July 1st, 1863, wounded Union soldiers were brought in here.
At one point, Christ Church became home for over 140 wounded men. Bodies laid throughout the sanctuary, staining the wooden floor. Others were taken downstairs for crude surgeries. Windows were broken and shattered by bullets, and the earth shook with cannon fire. Unfortunately, even the church was not safe from the fighting and confusion.
There was an army chaplain, his name was Horatio Howell, who was with the 90th Pennsylvania Volunteers. And Chaplain Howell came to this church to minister to the wounded while his men were fighting north and west of town. And at one point, Chaplain Howell decided to go out onto our front porch to get a breath of fresh air. One of the Confederates saw Howell standing at the top of the steps, and the Confederate demanded that Howell surrender. Howell started to argue and say, "You cannot take me prisoner, I'm a non-combatant," whereupon the Confederate shot and killed Howell.
At the steps now stands a monument of an open Bible, upon which two verses are displayed. "He delivereth me from mine enemies, yea, thou lifteth me up above those that rise against me." Psalms 18:48 and Hebrews 11:4, "He being dead, yet speaketh." On the first day of fighting, the Union retreated. Confederate troops began capturing free African Americans that remained in town. 15-year-old Albertus McCreary, the son of a wealthy family, watched in horror as their servant, old Liz Butler, was marched past as a prisoner. However, in the chaos of the fighting, Liz managed to escape her captors and ran inside Christ Church, not stopping until she had reached the bell tower. Here she remained without food or water for 3 days and 2 nights. On July 4th, she found Albertus and explained how she survived, saying, "Thank God I's alive yet." After listening to Ron share about the church's important role in the battle, we opened the old hymnal to sing a famous Civil War tune, the Battle Hymn of the Republic. Written in 1861 by abolitionist Julia Ward Howe, the song quickly became the theme of the Union Army. In the original version of the hymn, the final verse states, "As Christ died to make men holy, let us die to make men free." Here in Gettysburg and all throughout the country, there were soldiers who did just that, and like Christ, gave the ultimate sacrifice so that others could be free. When we come back, we'll see some of their stories. Our next stop brings us to the story of a soldier whose life was forever changed inside a different Gettysburg church. But first, we had to meet our tour guide, Dennis Kutzner, an accomplished historian, pastor, and author. He's toured the battlefield over 75 times, and now he's taking us along with him. Our group waded through the rain to Soldiers National Cemetery, which holds the distinction of being America's first national military graveyard. The cemetery was primarily the work of Pennsylvania Governor Andrew Curtin. Curtin contacted politicians across the country for support to ensure proper burial for Union soldiers who died at Gettysburg. Soldiers National Cemetery in Gettysburg is best known as a place where Abraham Lincoln gave the Gettysburg Address. Here, about 4 months after the battle, with thousands of bodies remaining to be buried, they dedicated the site. The keynote speaker was Edward Everett, one of the most renowned orators of the time. He spoke for nearly 2 hours, followed by a short address from President Abraham Lincoln that began with the words, 47 years ago.
The speech took less than 3 minutes, and when he sat down, Everett leaned over to him and said, "You said in 2.5 minutes more than I was able to say in 2 hours."
One of the many buried on these grounds is Union soldier William O. Doubleday. Originally from Sherburne, Vermont, Doubleday had been drafted into the Union Army. On the third day of the battle, he was shot while fighting against Pickett's charge.
It was during that conflict that Doubleday is wounded in his leg. And usually, if one of those 57, 58 caliber lead bullets hit an exposed limb, it shattered the bones. And at that time, the only way a surgeon could fix that is to go above the shattering and saw it off, and hopefully they would live.
Nothing could have prepared the government for the immense number of casualties caused by the conflict. Thousands of volunteers, many of them Christian groups, joined together to help the injured. Doubleday was taken to St. Francis Xavier Church in the middle of town, where the Catholic sisters tended to his many wounds. Here on the floor of the sanctuary, near the altar, Doubleday met a man named George Stewart. A successful businessman, Stewart was also the head of the United States Christian Commission. The group ministered to hurt soldiers, providing food and helping read and write letters home to their loved ones. Before Doubleday left his home in Vermont, his wife expressed her hope that he would return safely and as a good Christian. The couple took a moment for their 12-year-old son to pray for his father.
So here he comes to Gettysburg and realizes now he may not survive. And he knows his wife's a believer. His children are believers. He's not. By his testimony, he's been an evil man, a wicked man. He tells this all to Stuart. And then he begins to weep and to cry. And Stuart prays with him what we would consider today like a sinner's prayer. And Doubleday receives the Lord and is born again. And as a result of that, he's in heaven. Amen. He came to Gettysburg to fight a war, to fight and be in a conflict, which he did. He didn't come here to find Christ. But God had a different story and journey plan because of the prayers of his wife and his children.
His wife arrived in Gettysburg to see him before he died on August 14th. Rather than return his body to Vermont, she decided to have him buried here in the National Cemetery. A year later, George Stewart received a letter from the widow of William O. Doubleday, thanking him for being the answer to her and her son's prayers.
It's been estimated that roughly 25% of all the soldiers in the Civil War were Christian, both North and South. And I had an atheist that was here at the park that I used to talk to, and Greg would say to me, he says, you know, only 1/4 of the soldiers. Well, if there were 4 million soldiers that fought, that's 1 million soldiers were Christian, besides the number of men who found Christ as a result of that military experience. We know record-wise, in Lee's army alone and some of the other Southern armies, there were over 150,000 conversions.
Dennis said that it was the story of William O. Doubleday's conversion that led him to develop a tour of Gettysburg from the Christian perspective, a story which ironically was first shared with him by a friend who was an atheist. At that moment, standing in the rain at the National Cemetery, Dennis asked us to pray with him. We prayed for all those we know who did not know Jesus, that we could be like George Stewart and share the message of salvation with them.
We agree together for all family, friends, people that we've worked with around us that we know that are not Christian, that are not saved. We agree together here as touching their lives for their salvation, that you'll get the word to them and they'll respond in faith and be born again. We pray this, Lord, sincerely in Jesus' name. And everybody said together, amen. Amen.
We made our way out of the rain and back to the hotel for a roundtable discussion about Gettysburg. Here we talked about the movie that we had watched on the bus ride and some of the theological questions raised by the war itself. Some of us could have stayed up all night talking, but we had to go to bed. We were getting ready to get up early the next day to tour the battlefield. With slightly better weather than yesterday, we piled into the bus and headed for the battlefield. Dennis pointed to some interesting sights along the way until we made it to our first stop, Pender's Division Marker. General William Dorsey Pender hailed from North Carolina. He commanded a brigade in the Army of Northern Virginia and at the age of 29 became one of the youngest generals in the Confederacy. Unlike many Southerners at the time, Pender disagreed with the institution of slavery. One of the reasons for this, perhaps, was his reading of the novel Uncle Tom's Cabin. Written by abolitionist Harriet Beecher Stowe, the book tells the story of a long-suffering slave and the tragedies that befall his friends and family due to the slavery in the South. Stowe was inspired to write the book after she experienced a vision from God during a communion service at Bowdoin College, where her husband was a professor. The book had significant impact on the abolitionist movement, selling over 350,000 copies in the first year. Politicians banned the book in the South, making it all more impressive that Pender had read it.
When she was asked by the press, how'd you write this book? Her answer, which is in her biography that was written by her son Charles, me write this book? I didn't write this book. God gave me the words to this book. God gave me the words. The answer to the question, where was God during the Civil War? God was where he always is, working through godly people who are willing to let their light shine so that others can hear the story of redemption.
Redemption is central to the story of William Dorsey Pender, who prior to the war was not a Christian. Stirred by the devotion of his wife, Mary Frances, Pender investigated the belief that played such an important role in her life. We know from letters he wrote on the battlefield that he was struggling to work out his newfound faith. At Fanny's encouragement, Pender decided to be baptized, inviting his entire regiment to accompany him. Through his wife's unending support, he slowly realized that being a Christian meant a commitment to follow God every day, not just one time. On the afternoon of July 2nd, he and his division were not yet engaged in the Battle of Gettysburg, and Pender was curious about what was holding them back. Along with several other officers, General Pender ventured out on horseback to catch a glimpse of the battle and find out where his men could intervene. Unfortunately, an artillery shot exploded nearby, sending shrapnel into his left leg. Pender had already been wounded 4 times in previous battles and had survived, but this one would ultimately prove to be fatal. In his last moments, Pender instructed his doctor to write a final letter to his wife, Fanny, saying,
"I do not fear to die. I can confidently resign my soul to God, trusting in the atonement of Jesus Christ. My only regret is to leave you and our 2 children. I have always tried to do my duty in every sphere in which Providence has placed me."
Like so many Christians, Pender had wrestled with understanding his faith. But through his wife's support and the Lord's power, he ultimately found peace. His body was returned to North Carolina, and an epitaph was placed across his grave saying, "Patriot by nature, soldier by training, Christian by faith."
Lord, thank you as we stand on this sacred field. You used a great man to do things that he wanted to do from the time that he was a young man. And he used this occasion, this opportunity, to set us on the right path. We're facing some difficult hours in front of us. The gospel has been put aside by many areas, but yet the truth of it is we can still pray, and you're still free to move, and you do move. And it's only through the moving of your spirit that we're going to see true and real revival. And we know it has to start in us. We're desperate for your move. We're desperate for your power, desperate for what only you can do. And we thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this great country. Help us to be faithful in every sphere that we have influence. We pray in Christ's name. Amen.
At only 29 years old, the loss of such a young and talented officer was felt throughout the Confederacy. General Robert E. Lee expressed his sadness at Pender's passing, saying, "The loss of Major General Pender is severely felt in the Army and the country. His promise and usefulness as an officer were only equaled by the purity and excellence of his private life." During our trip, we had the privilege of meeting a very talented living history reenactor who has studied General Lee for years. When he speaks about the Battle of Gettysburg, it sounds as if he was actually here 150 years ago, and he still is disappointed with the outcome.
Blame could be placed on everybody at that point in time. You know, people tried to blame Stuart because he did not arrive here till 6 o'clock on July 2nd. They tried to blame everyone else, but ultimately, as the commanding general of the Army of Northern Virginia, it was my fault. I'm the one who developed the battle plan. As a leader, you always try to surround yourself with people who have possessed the same type of attitude that you do, can possess the same goal, that can put aside their egos, and unfortunately that was not the case here.
Lee's humility and his sense of responsibility made him a prolific leader. His ability to recognize the strength of his comrades made it all more difficult when they were lost in battle. Lee believes that had it not been for the death of General Thomas Stonewall Jackson in May of 1863, the Battle of Gettysburg would have gone differently.
My biggest problem would be to have him stop, because he would have captured Culp's Hill, Cemetery Hill, and they would have kept going to Philadelphia, Baltimore City, and Washington City. He knew exactly what I had in mind, what I was thinking before I even verbalized it. And he never allowed his ego to get in the way of our being successful. He accepted that we always had to accomplish a goal that would benefit the masses and not just individuals.
By the time he surrendered in 1865, Lee's life had been devastated by the fighting. He had given everything for the sake of the Confederacy and his beloved Virginia. He even lost his home after the Union turned his Arlington estate into a burial ground. With the war over, he turned his attentions to rebuilding the country that he loved so much, focusing on the young men who would be the leaders in the future.
You know, as the commanding general of the Army of Northern Virginia, you wake up, you wake every morning, and the first thing you're presented is a piece of paper with 2 small words on it, "Killed and wounded." Because I had to make decisions which sent the thing I loved the most, the men in my army, into harm's way. When I became president of Washington College, I then awoke every day making decisions that benefited my boys. I told them point blank that if we, the South, is going to assume our proper role in the reunification, the restoration of the nation, then it was up to them. We had to basically say the way the South lived in the past was dead. We had to put aside, we had to bury the dead, the past, our goals, our aspirations. It was up to them to carry that flag of the South.
For a man with as many accomplishments as Lee, it's surprising that he doesn't consider the presidency of Washington College or his leadership of the Confederate Army as his proudest accomplishment. Instead, it was a simple act on a Sunday morning.
It was 2 weeks after April 9th, 1865, and my wife and I were attending church at St. Paul's Episcopal Church in Richmond. And it came time for communion. We were sitting in our pew. All the white people were sitting down on the bottom level. The black people were sitting in their place in the balcony. When all of a sudden, when it came time for communion, I heard this little rustling in the balcony. Gray-haired black man left his seat, walked over to the steps, walked downstairs, and walked right up the aisle to take communion. The white people on the bottom level were aghast. How could this man do this? Then all of a sudden, a silver-haired gentleman arose from his pew, walked to the end of that pew, and walked down the aisle, knelt right next to that black man, and took communion with him. Of all the accomplishments in my life, that is the event of which I am the proudest.
As our tour group made our way down Confederate Avenue, we saw monuments to the Southern soldiers who fought here. It's humbling to think of their bravery and their sacrifice. Our next stop was a group of monuments dedicated to heroes from the Union whose courageous actions changed the country forever. While the Union may have lacked the leadership of Robert E. Lee, it still had many bold, courageous men among its army's ranks. One of these men was Colonel Strong Vincent, who helped to save the day for the Union on July the 2nd. As our bus rolled onward, Dennis took us to a place of great strategic importance to the battle, Little Round Top. Covered in honeysuckle and wildflowers, this rocky hill seemed peaceful and serene, a far cry from the chaos and the bloodshed that happened here in 1863. The afternoon of July 2nd, Union Brigadier General G.K. Warren climbed Little Round Top to find that hardly any troops were in this valuable position. He knew having the high ground gave armies a distinct advantage and hurried to occupy the hill before the Confederates. A messenger was sent to find Brigadier General Barnes in hopes that he could provide troops to hold the hill. However, before the messenger found Barnes, he encountered 26-year-old Colonel Strong Vincent. Vincent did not have a military background. Prior to the war, he practiced law in Erie, Pennsylvania, after graduating from Harvard in 1859. But when the fighting broke out, his sense of duty led him to volunteer for the Army. He wrote to his wife, who he married the day he enlisted.
"If I fall, remember, you have given your husband to the most righteous cause that ever widowed a woman."
Vincent quickly rose through the ranks and was promoted to lieutenant colonel and then colonel. Following the death of his commanding officer, Vincent assumed the command of the 83rd Pennsylvanian. Vincent had been raised an Episcopalian, but it is unknown what role faith played in his adult life. He did, however, have a strong sense of loyalty and patriotism. Just days before his arrival in Gettysburg, as his brigade passed through Maryland, Vincent looked up at the Union flag and remarked,
"What death more glorious can any man desire than to die on the soil of old Pennsylvania, fighting for that flag?"
Now on the soil of Gettysburg, Vincent's quick action would help turn the tide of the battle. After stopping the messenger, he demanded that the rider tell his orders.
Vincent grabbed the horse's reins of that rider and says, "What are your orders?" And he says, "I'm looking for General Barnes." He says, "Well, I don't know where he is," but he says, "What are your orders?" He would not let go of the reins. Finally, the officer says, "General Warren wants a brigade on that hill." Vincent said, "I'll take the responsibility."
With only minutes to spare, Vincent brought his men up Little Round Top to assist Warren as the enemy approached. Fighting broke out, and the Confederates began to put serious pressure on Vincent's regiments. In the confusion, some of the soldiers thought the signal was given to retreat and began to fall back at a very critical moment. Sensing the danger, Vincent climbed atop a boulder and brandished a horse whip given to him by his wife, shouting to the troops,
"Do not give an inch!"
The retreat ceased, but a bullet struck Vincent in his thigh, causing a wound that would kill him 5 days later. Although as an adult, Vincent had fallen away from his Christian upbringing, his last days brought him back to the Lord. He was taken to a nearby farm, but doctors were unable to help him very much. As he lay dying from his wounds, he began to recite the Lord's Prayer, a remnant of his Episcopal upbringing.
On earth, as it is in heaven.
Vincent's troops returned to the boulder where he had stood with his wife's riding crop and carved out a reminder in the stone. Head of Union Forces General George Meade recommended Colonel Vincent for promotion to Brigadier General, but it is unlikely he ever knew. If you look closely at the figure atop Pennsylvania 83rd Monument, it bears a striking resemblance to the colonel who died on the soil of old Pennsylvania fighting for his flag. On the other side of Little Round Top, another hero had arrived to hold off the Confederate surge coming up the hill. Colonel Patrick Henry O'Rourke, known as Paddy, was born in Ireland, and his family moved to America in search of a better life when he was 1 year old. While they settled in New York, the family planned for him to attend college until his father died in a work accident in a marble quarry. Young Patrick took it upon himself to support his family by taking over his father's job, but his mother insisted that her sons receive an education. Working three jobs, she helped to put him through school. He attended West Point and graduated valedictorian of the class of 1861. A devout Roman Catholic, Patty had a strong sense of duty and dedication. He was well-liked among his comrades, who lovingly called him Dad due to his bushy sideburns. He was known for being a selfless leader, as well as a very intelligent man. His work in the Army Corps of Engineers helped prepare the defenses of Washington, D.C. By the time he had reached Gettysburg, he was promoted to Colonel of the 140th New York Regiment. On the second day of the battle, General Warren came to him desperately in need of help.
It's the firing that's going on here on the south end of the hill because of acoustics. Warren can't hear it. He doesn't hear the firing. So he himself goes down on the other side of the hill and he runs into Paddy O'Rourke, Patrick Henry O'Rourke from Rochester, New York.
Warren, not knowing that Strong Vincent's men already were fighting on the hill, asked O'Rourke to help him. O'Rourke obliged and headed up the hill, leading his men from the front rather than from the rear, hoping to inspire them through his own selfless bravery. As things began to look bleak for Vincent, Paddy O'Rourke crested the hill and shouted, "Over here, boys!" pointed his sword in the direction of the fighting, and immediately his men rushed to assist Colonel Vincent. But in that moment, O'Rourke was struck in the throat with a bullet and fell dead on the battlefield. Years later, Paddy O'Rourke's regiment returned to erect a monument to the colonel, sideburns and all. His face shines in the sun as tourists rub his nose, believing it will bring the luck of the Irish. Above his head are the words, fraternity, valor, patriotism, and duty.
I ask myself the question, what if Paddy O'Rourke would have lived? He's a colonel now, what would he have been by the end of the war? Graduated first in his class at West Point, you know, very popular by the end of the war. Could he have become a senator? Could he have become a congressman? Could he have become governor of New York? Could he have been the first Roman Catholic president? Well, we will never know. And when those men came across the hill that day and their commander said, "Over here, boys," and they all knew what that meant and what they had to do, they didn't have time to write home, didn't have time to do anything else, didn't have time to think. All they had time to do was to do their duty. And they did it. And I ask us here today, we each have a duty. We each have a destiny. Even if we're in retirement, we have a responsibility. We have a plan that God has for our life. Are we doing our duty? Are we serving the Lord? Are we giving to Him? You know, they were fighting for a great cause, were they not? They believed in what they were doing. We have a greater cause, much greater cause. Ours is an eternal cause. And while we're here, we have a duty to do. Will we do our duty? Will we be faithful? Would they be able to put on our tombstone? Duty.
Our next stop is known for one of the greatest heroes of Gettysburg, and we'll look deeper into the man whose action may have saved the entire country. On the far end of the Union line, looking down the southern slope of Little Round Top, was Union Colonel Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain. He was not your typical soldier. A professor from Bowdoin College in Brunswick, Maine, he spoke 9 different languages and taught religion and rhetoric. A friend of author Harriet Beecher Stowe, he too was an abolitionist. When the war broke out, he felt the call to serve, frustrated at his colleagues' lack of enthusiasm for what he saw as a just cause. He wrote the governor of Maine, saying,
"I fear this war will not cease until men of the North are willing to leave good positions and sacrifice the dearest personal interests to rescue our country from desolation."
Under the pretense of traveling to Europe for studies, the college granted him a 2-year leave of absence. Instead, Chamberlain immediately enlisted in the Army. What he lacked in military experience, he made up for in dedication. By July 2nd, 1863, he had become colonel of the 20th Maine Regiment. At the orders of Strong Vincent, Chamberlain was instructed to hold the end of the Union line to the last on the south side of Little Round Top. As Confederate troops led by Colonel William Oates from the 15th Alabama Regiment charged the hill again and again.
So by the fourth or fifth time that the Alabamans had come up the hill, Chamberlain realizes many of the guys were literally out of ammunition. They had used the ammunition from their supply, and they had used the ammunition that was in the guns and in the pockets of other soldiers that were dead or wounded. They were out. What was the only thing you could do? Well, Chamberlain says, gosh, there's only one thing I know to do, and that's to charge these guys. To run down this hill and charge them, and hoping, you know, he figured out they've got to be as tired as we are.
The Alabamans had already marched 20 miles that day and had been unable to find water to refill their canteens. With nothing left to lose, Chamberlain ordered a bayonet charge down the hill.
It was imperative to strike before we were struck by this overwhelming force in a hand-to-hand fight. At that crisis, I ordered the bayonet.
By all accounts, the men already figured out what they were going to do. So the order was not really an order. But when he ordered up the charge, everybody lined up, they all charged down the hill. And their momentum, running into the Confederates, they were spent. Most of them gave up or turned around and ran back out of the way. So he saves the day.
This charge was successful beyond all my hopes. We took twice as many prisoners as we had men in our ranks. The result of this movement, beyond question, was the saving of Round Top itself.
Chamberlain survived the end of the war, going on to serve as the governor of Maine and the president of Bowdoin College. In 1889, he returned to Gettysburg to dedicate these monuments, and in 1893, he was awarded the Congressional Medal of Honor for his courage here on the battlefield.
We know not of the future and cannot plan for it much. But we can hold our spirits and our bodies so pure and high that we can determine and know what manner of men we will be when the hour strikes that calls to noble action. Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain.
Our last stop on the tour was the famous Copse of Trees. Here Dennis shares a story not of an individual soldier, but of the reconciliation and forgiveness of hundreds. On the third day of battle, the Confederates charged the Union line in the direction of this small group of trees. Known as Pickett's Charge, for Major General George Pickett, the attack proved disastrous, causing significant losses for their army. At the base of the trees stands a monument for the high water mark of the Confederacy, which marks the furthest the army ever advanced into Union territory. Viewed today as one of the major turning points in the battle, things may have been different had the Confederates' plans worked that day.
Most people think it was just a frontal assault, but it was not. There were 5 components to it. Ewell, was supposed to attack the left flank, AP Hill, the right flank. Cavalry charged from the rear by Jeb Stuart, but he was stopped, of course, at East Cavalry Field. And then, of course, an artillery barrage, in which General Pendleton was supposed to enfilade those men across. But he, for some reason, he took those 47 artillery pieces and he placed them in reserve. So the five components, the only one that actually met fruition was the frontal assault. Had General Pickett's Virginians been supported the way they were supposed to have been, and I'm still waiting someone to tell me why they were not, we could have had a glorious victory here at Gettysburg.
Those who did make it this far were met with brutal fighting conditions. Instead of shells, cannons fired shrapnel against the infantry at close range. Soldiers who had run out of ammo were reduced to fighting hand to hand with bayonets, sticks, and even rocks. Yet, the Union line held. Years after the battle, the surviving veterans were invited back for a reunion. When the former enemies came together once again, the results were unbelievable.
The stands for the reenactment are on either side of us here, and the word was that there were going to be men from Pickett's Charge and from the Union who were going to restage Pickett's Charge. They put the Confederate guys just a few yards over the wall that way, stood the Union guys on this side of the wall like they would have been, and they said now they're going to reenact the charge. All right, so the Confederate guys start toward the Union line. Literally, as they begin walking, suddenly the Union guys step across the wall and begin walking toward them, and the crowd begins to cry, "No, no, that's not how it happened." And they met each other on the field and wept and cried, hugging one another. And the crowd was hushed.
A half century after the deadliest battle on U.S. soil, two former enemies embraced as old friends. It's a moving testimony of God's healing power, how only He could bring together the two broken halves of a nation and make it stronger than ever before. We left the battlefield that day inspired. We saw the hand of God in each of these stories, in the salvation of William O. Doubleday, the persistence of William Dorsey Pender, the devotion of Robert E. Lee, in the courage of Strong Vincent, the honor of Patrick O'Rourke, the loyalty of Joshua Lawrence Chamberlain, and the reconciliation of those two great armies. Amidst the chaos of battle, Christ was ever present. 150 years later, this leaves a powerful lesson for you and me.
Let's let the real combat that we have not be against flesh and blood, but let's do the warfare, and let's do it as bravely and as ferociously as the men here did for us.
Our tour was over, but our journey was not. We were headed to lunch, but this time it came with a show. For lunch, we stopped at the historic Dobbin House Tavern. Built in 1776, it was the home of Reverend Alexander Dobbin and his family, who were starting a new life in America. During the 1800s, the Dobbin's house played an important role as a stop on the Underground Railroad. While our group was excited to have some home cooking, the big attraction for today was what came after the meal. Frank and Bonnie Orlando have made a name for themselves as Civil War reenactors. Performing as General Robert E. Lee and his wife, Mary Anna Custis Lee, they put on quite a show for us.
And I tell you, I'm enjoying this reception much better than the one I received the first time I visited Gettysburg. People here weren't too happy to see me, and I have no idea why.
The couple has extensively researched the history of the general and his wife, memorizing stories and quotes from the past. But their performance isn't merely factual. Like any real couple, they banter and argue, often with humorous results.
Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Especially all you wonderful, wonderful ladies.
You know, Mr. Lee leads such a toilsome life, he needs some recreation. Don't worry about it, madam.
And when you're 208 like me, I'm definitely no threat.
God blessed us with a wonderful time in Gettysburg. We realized that although many of us may have never met before, we shared many interests. We loved the study of history, and the chance to explore such an important part of our nation's past. By the end of the tour, we really felt like family. The Battle of Gettysburg changed the Civil War and ultimately the way our country views itself. No longer were we a loose alliance of independent states. God used something that tore us apart to ultimately unite us as a nation. Along with visiting the sites of Gettysburg, our group learned the God story and how in the midst of a terrible battle, he demonstrated his love, mercy, and his grace. Brave men on both sides of the struggle gave their all for God, for honor, and for country. Soon it was time to hop back on the bus and return to Pittsburgh. While we were sad to be going home, our friends wanted to share what they thought about our trip.
You know, it's amazing how many soldiers were involved in this battle and knowing how much God was really involved in this battle, you know, for the freedom of the United, you know, America. And that's, you know, the main thing.
I think from the moment that Terry decided to do this and brought us along, it was one of the most magnificent trips in the world. And one of the things that I think I really liked more than anything was the fact that it was so spiritual and how they brought God into it and how it wasn't just a tour, but it was a spiritual tour, you know, it was a spiritual thing. And God was really in this whole tour.
Well, what I really enjoyed about it was the fact that he was a fellow minister, and being a born-again Christian and a minister myself, I really enjoyed the fact that he went out on the battlefield and shared about the different men that were ministers and the fact that he prayed out there in the battlefield for us and for families and so on.
My favorite part was the fellowship part. Dennis was fantastic. I learned that in school we learn about the war, but we don't learn about the lives of these people and the young men. And it impressed me when he told us that on the 4th of July, both sides walked down the middle of the street together to honor our country. That is something we don't learn in school.
Yes, it was a fantastic trip. This is a spiritual experience coming to Gettysburg. I've been here many times. What I liked about this particular trip was the centrality of God in the affairs of men. And the testimonies from some of the soldiers, even from the grave, they still speak.
Just seeing the battlefields where all the soldiers were and the hospitals that they used, the buildings, I was very impressed by that.
I love the discussion, especially concerning the spiritual aspect of the Civil War. That question is often asked, where was God during this time? And you know what? You come on out and you get that question answered when you see it.
Probably seeing Robert E. Lee and his wife, I thought it was so informative. I like that it kind of gave you a different spin on what I always assumed of history. They were very Christian and upstanding. I could have listened to them even longer. They were just so gracious.
The trip was fantastic. They did a terrific job of guiding us, of telling us everything that was coming up, so we knew exactly what we were doing. And I met so many good Christian people here that I'll never forget.
I cried, I laughed. I just loved the whole thing. I really did. I just loved the whole thing.
You know what? I thought it was absolutely wonderful. I made a lot of new friends, and if they have another trip, I will gladly sign up for it again.
We want
great
to
people.
Yeah, we'd love to thank Terry and Dawn mm-hmm. and CTV, because
yes.
This was awesome, and we give the glory to God for mm-hmm. them being able to do this.
Oh my gosh, you couldn't have asked for a more well-organized, fun trip with like just a great group of people. Everybody was patient with one another, and my sister's like, let's do this trip. And neither one of us had been to Gettysburg, so I'm elated. I everything was great. Everybody was so kind.
And I believe that we learned a lot from the excellent guide, and the spiritual aspect, again, is so important to us as a people in the United States of America to understand where we've come from, who we are, and where we need to go.
Oh,
lots of fun,
yeah,
fun,
it's a very,
fun.
Very great trip, yeah. Fun. We definitely, you know, suggest to do it more, you know.
Yeah, we're ready
for different
the next
places,
one.
Yeah.
I'm packing for the next trip, okay? Where
right.
are we going?
We are thankful for the chance to visit such an important part of American history and to learn how God's hand was present through it all. And I'm thankful that you could be part of it.
Cornerstone Television wishes to thank all our faithful viewers whose consistent prayers and financial support have made this program possible.